Copacabana, the hottest place north of Havana. Barry Manilow is still singing that, ladies and gentlemen, and that's what my book is about. It's called Copacabana Sexcapades, and I'm going to tell you all about it today. But first of all, I want to mention something. Did you notice that wonderful introduction that I got from Dr. Philip Terman? Thank you. He said, meet and greet Tony Carol Terman, original Copa Girl dancer, singer, recording artist, and author of three books. Copacabana Sexcapades, Legs Galore, which is the history of the famous Latin Quarter, inspired by Barbara Walters. And then we have Laugh Your Fat Off, which is all about staying slim and healthy. Oh, I know. There's a lady here that has a question. Oh, yeah, I see your hand. Oh, I know. You want to know all about the stars at the Copacabana, especially Frank Sinatra, because I remember you told me that. Okay, here we have Dean Martin, Frank Sinatra, Jerry Lewis. I worked with all of these stars, and I was just a kid from St. Louis, Missouri, and I came to the big city, auditioned, got the job, thank God. And I call these my college professors. And I do want to tell, and all these people are terrific, like Jimmy Durante and Tony Martin, Eddie Fisher and Johnny Ray and George Burns and Danny Thomas and Rodney Dangerfield and Tom Jones and more. They're all in the book. But I do want to tell you one story about Frank Sinatra. I think you get a kick out of this. As a matter of fact, there was a time when he had just won an Academy Award at Columbia Pictures for a movie that was called From Here to Eternity. Anybody remember that? From Here to Eternity. And so it was at that time that he decided to open up at the famous Copacabana. So there he is at the Copa, and he chooses a wonderful comedian to open up the show for him. And the comic comes out, and he's absolutely flabbergasted on opening night because he looks out at the people in the audience, and lo and behold, every star from Hollywood, California was there simply because he was a star in Hollywood. And they were all sitting there ringside. Elizabeth Taylor, and at that time she was married to Mike Todd. And then there was Joe DiMaggio sitting ringside, and Ava Gardner, and Lucille Ball, and Desi Arnaz, and Beth Midler, and Milton Berle. I'm telling you, this comic was so flabbergasted that he could hardly think. And then he looks up, and he sees this magnificent woman standing at the top of the stairway. She was beautiful, blonde, and she had this gorgeous white diaphanous dress on and a wonderful white fox fur that went all the way down to her feet. And ladies and gentlemen, guess who it was? It was Marilyn Monroe. And he looked at her, Joey Bishop looked at her, and he said, "I thought I told you to wait in the truck." Well, I want to tell you, the house really, really laughed and laughed and laughed. It was just incredible. As a matter of fact, that evening, it was very customary that after the show, what would happen is all the stars would go to Lindy's, which was on Broadway. Joey Bishop, the comic, walks into Lindy's, and the moment he walks in the front door, everybody was there that was sitting ringside at the Copacabana. And the moment he walks in, because he delivered that line, they all stood up and gave him a standing ovation. And you know what? From that day on, Joey Bishop was a star. But I do want to tell you more about Frank Sinatra. We all love Frank Sinatra. My husband and I play his records constantly. But I want to tell you, he had the best looking blue eyes I ever saw in my whole life. As a matter of fact, when you looked into his eyes, you thought that you were going off to another planet. They were totally mesmerizing, absolutely. And so there, the time goes by, and here I am in Hollywood, and I'm with one of the most beautiful Copa girls. Her name is Joan Tyler. She was a buddy of mine. And I remember when she auditioned for the Copacabana, and Duck County was the choreographer at the time, and Joan Tyler comes in, and she was so magnificent. At that time, she was a Powers model, really beautiful. And Duck County was really taken with her. And he said, well, tell me about your dancing background. And she said, well, I do the cha-cha. And she said, and I can do this step too. You want to see more? And he said, he was so mesmerized with her good looks. He said, no, you've got the job. Anyway, so you kind of have the idea about how really good looking this female was. So here we are back in Hollywood. Joan Tyler is one of my buddies. And Frank Sinatra has been dating Joan Tyler. He used to date all the Copa girls. As a matter of fact, one day about 5 o'clock, I'm at Joan Tyler's house. And the phone rings, and it's Frank Sinatra. And he calls, and he says, "Joan, I'm in the neighborhood, and I'd like to come over and make you some of that good spaghetti that I've been telling you about." And she says, "Okay, come on over." So he comes over. This is really a riot. So here comes Frank Sinatra. He heads for the kitchen. He gets the pan out, and he puts a big stick of butter in it. Then he chops up this garlic. He sticks the garlic and the butter, and it's sautéed. Oh, it smells so wonderful. And now he's got the spaghetti, and it's boiling over here on this other burner. And he drains the spaghetti, and he puts it in the sautéed butter and the garlic. And I want to tell you, it smelled out of this world. And sure enough, we sat down. He put some of that fresh Romano cheese on it. Romano cheese, that's the best thing you could do on spaghetti. And lo and behold, we're sitting there and we're having wine and spaghetti with Sinatra. It was delicious. And then I want to tell you something more. I want to tell you about my really good friend, George Burns. I love George Burns, and you would have loved him too. He had a wonderful sense of humor. Wherever he went, he was always in a very jolly sense of humor. He would be rhyming things all the time. He'd be telling jokes all the time. He was just wonderful. So I went to Hollywood to interview all these stars, and you can see them in the book. As a matter of fact, I went and I interviewed over 150 stars for Copacabana Sexcapades. And what happened at that time, he opened the doors to people like Danny Thomas and Amsterdam, another comedian by the name of Amsterdam. And lo and behold, what happened is that I was able to interview all these people. It was just fantastic. So finally I said to George Burns, I said, "George, you know, George, I should interview you for heaven's sake." I said, "I never appeared at the Copacabana. I was never an act," he said. "I was just in the audience all the time with Gracie Allen." "Oh, okay." I said, "But what did you think of the Copa girls, George?" He said, "Had them all." "Okay." I said, "Well, what did you think of Julie Padel?" He was the big, husky, villain-type boss. I said, "What did you think of him?" And he said, "Oh, I had him too." Right. So we know he always had a good sense of humor. And then, all of a sudden, what happened is that who comes down the aisle? But who was that that came down the aisle? You were sitting there that day. Tell me who came down the aisle. Was it Ava Gardner? Oh, yeah, it was Ava Gardner. And as I said, she was there at the very beginning. And so, but I do want to tell you, we have hands up. This lady wants to know, she wants to know, how can her little girl get in show business? Oh, and then she wants to know, how did I get in show business as well? I will answer both of those questions. First, at the end of this lecture, I have a flyer, and I will give it out to all the mothers that are interested in training their children to be in the theater and how to go about it. And this flyer will give you all the details. And if you have any questions, you just ask me and I'll tell you. Okay, now you want to know, how did I get in show business? Okay, there I am, St. Louis, Missouri. I'm just a little kid. I've dreamed of being in show business all my life. I went and my mom was a widow and she had 3 children. And I just loved her dearly and I would do anything for my mother. So my mom, as a child, said, "Okay, you do the laundry every Saturday afternoon in the basement." So here we are in St. Louis, and I'm in the basement, and I'm bored to death with the laundry. It's going on for hours and hours. So I began to search around the building because a lot of people used to put their newspapers in the corner of the basement. So as the years went by, I would go to the theatrical section of all these newspapers, and I would find everybody from St. Louis that was in show business. And Dunn County was constantly getting publicity in St. Louis, bizarre. And lo and behold, there I am. By the time I was a teenager, I had a whole scrapbook on Doug Cowdy. So when I went to New York City, I immediately went to 10 East 60th Street with the scrapbook. And I walked in at 10 East 60th Street as if I owned the place. And I said, I'm here to see Mr. Douglas Cowdy, and I have a scrapbook for him. So the busboy went to get Douglas Cowdy, and Doug comes out. And I said, "Hi, Doug, I'm Tony Carroll from St. Louis, Missouri, and I went to the Cracker School of Music, and I have a scrapbook that I've been keeping for you all my life." So he looks at the scrapbook, and I'm standing there, and I'm sure he's mesmerized with what he's looking at. And finally I said, "Well, Doug," I said, "do you think I'm pretty enough to be a Copa girl?" And he finally looks up and he says, "Oh yeah," he says, "you're pretty enough. But you know what? You're a little tall." He said, oh, "don't worry. We'll put you in the middle and we'll get the girls to escalate down this way." So you can see, ladies and gentlemen, I really had a very lucky, serendipitous life. One more thing, I want to tell you that I love comics. I always say it. I'll never forget George Burns one night when he was performing and he looked out at the audience and he said, "You're a great audience. Champagne for everybody in the audience. And when the check comes, give it to him." He was only kidding because he was a joker at all times.